Hello everyone, welcome to this session on joints of the upper limb. In this session we'll be revising all the joints of the upper limb. Okay, so here I've listed down the major joints of the upper limb. There's the shoulder joint, then elbow joint and wrist joint, and first carpometacarpal joint. Okay, these are the joints which are most frequently asked in examination, so we'll be covering these joints under these headings. Okay, these are the standard headings in which any joint is described. So let's start with the shoulder joint first. Here in this image, we can see the right shoulder region. So shoulder joint will be covering under these headings. So let's start with the first heading, that is the type of the joint. Shoulder joint is which type of joint? It is an example of a ball and socket variety of synovial joint. Then what are the articular surfaces which forms the shoulder joint? Here we can see the head of the humerus. The ball component of ball and socket is formed by the head of the humerus, and socket is formed by the glenoid cavity. The glenoid cavity is a part of scapula, and surrounding the glenoid cavity there is a thick margin which is referred to as glenoidal labrum. Okay, so glenoid cavity and glenoidal labrum, they form the socket. Okay, so this, it's a ball and socket variety of synovial joint. And let's cover the ligaments of the shoulder joint. Shoulder joint is an example of a synovial joint. Okay, so any synovial joint, when we study, it has a capsule covering it. So capsular ligament is the first ligament which we can say. Then with respect to the humerus, we can remember three ligaments. One is the glenohumeral ligament. It is nothing but a thickening on the inner aspect of the fibrous capsule. Okay, there are three bands of glenohumeral ligament. Then there's a ligament from the base of the coracoid process up to the greater tubercle, that is the coracohumeral ligament. And there is a ligament which stretches in between the greater and the lesser tubercles of the humerus, that is the transverse humeral ligament. Okay, so with respect to the humerus, three ligaments are glenohumeral ligament, coracohumeral ligament and transverse humeral ligament. And one was the capsular ligament. So these are the four ligaments in the shoulder joint. Okay, and there are some accessory ligaments as well. Here there will be a ligament extending from the coracoid process to the acromion process, that is the coracoacromial ligament, that forms the coracoacromial arch. Okay, and then let's cover the relations of the shoulder joint. So here in this image we can see the various relations of shoulder joint. So get first, orient yourself towards the image. This is the anterior aspect, this is the posterior aspect, this is the superior and this is the inferior aspect. Okay, it's a schematic diagram to show the various relations of shoulder joint. So on the anterior aspect, what we can see, the four structures in the anterior relation of the shoulder joint are deltoid, coracobrachialis and short head of the bicep, subscapularis muscle, and underneath it there is a bursa, that is the subscapular bursa. Okay, these are the anterior relations. Let's cover the posterior relations. Posteriorly also there is deltoid. So here there will be the posterior fibers of deltoid, then infraspinatus muscle and teres minor muscle. Okay, so these three structures are forming the posterior relations of the shoulder joint. An inferior relation is formed by the axillary nerve and posterior circumflex humeral vessels. And there is a muscle that is the long head of the triceps, okay, long head of triceps brachii. These structures are forming the inferior relation. And when we see the superior relation, that is, here is the supraspinatus muscle, and then there is a coracoacromial arch. Okay, this is the coracoid process, this is the acromion process. Connecting between them is the coracoacromial ligament, and these three structures together are referred to as the coracoacromial arch. These are the various relations of the shoulder joint. Apart from relations, bursae of the shoulder joint are also visible here. Bursae are nothing but extensions of the synovial membrane. This forming a cavity here, this is the subscapular bursa. Then there is subacromial bursa and infraspinatus bursa. Okay, so three bursa visible are the subscapular bursa, subacromial bursa and infraspinatus bursa. So we have covered these five headings. Let's start with the blood supply of the shoulder joint. So shoulder joint will be supplied by the vessels which are nearby. So here, as we know, the circumflex humeral vessels, anterior circumflex humeral artery, the posterior circumflex humeral artery, and near the scapula there is a suprascapular artery and subscapular artery. Okay, so all these vessels will be supplying the shoulder joint. The nerve supply will be by the nerves which are surrounding the shoulder joint. At the surgical neck of the humerus, we know that there is a nerve that is the axillary nerve. Then suprascapular nerve, which is nearby, that also supplies the shoulder joint. And the nerve of the anterior compartment of the arm, musculocutaneous nerve, also gives the branch to the shoulder joint. Okay, so three nerves supplying the shoulder joint are axillary nerve, suprascapular nerve, and musculocutaneous nerve. Okay, let's cover the movements of the shoulder joint. The shoulder joint is a multiaxial joint, so multiple movements are possible: flexion, extension, then adduction, abduction, medial rotation, lateral rotation, and combination of these movements will be referred to as circumduction. Okay, so when we study the movements, the muscles producing these movements also we should be knowing. So flexion is brought about by pectoralis major muscle and the anterior fibers of the deltoid muscle. Extension is brought about by the posterior fibers of the deltoid and latissimus dorsi muscle. Okay, so when we study the muscles producing action, there are some accessory muscles as well, but for exam point of view, we should at least know the chief muscles which cause that particular action. For adduction, there is sternocostal part of the pectoralis major and latissimus dorsi. For latissimus dorsi, three actions we can remember: adduction, medial rotation, and extension. Okay, just like in swimming, adduction, medial rotation, and extension. So here we can see latissimus dorsi is in adduction also, latissimus dorsi is in medial rotation also, latissimus dorsi is also seen in extension. Okay, then abduction, initiation of abduction is by supraspinatus muscle, and 15 to 90 degrees of abduction is by the deltoid muscle. Okay, beyond which it is done by serratus anterior and upper and lower fibers of the trapezius muscle. And medial rotation is by the subscapularis muscle, which is attached along the lesser tubercle. When it contracts, it will pull the humerus medially, so it will cause the medial rotation of the shoulder joint. And lateral rotation is by the posterior fibers of deltoid as well as muscles which are attached along the greater tubercle, so infraspinatus, teres minor. When they contract, they will cause the lateral rotation at the shoulder joint. Let's cover the applied anatomy related to the shoulder joint. So because of the wide range of mobility, shoulder joint is more prone to dislocation. Okay, and dislocation of the shoulder joint mostly occurs on the inferior aspect. When you study about the attachment of the capsular ligament, it is weak along the inferior aspect. Okay, so shoulder joint mostly it dislocates on the inferior aspect, and then it is pulled anteriorly. So clinical presentation is anterior dislocation of the shoulder. Okay, then frozen shoulder refers to the inflammation and shrinking of the joint capsule. Okay, when the joint capsule is shrunken, that leads to adhesive capsulitis, also referred to as frozen shoulder, which restricts the movement of the shoulder joint. Then osteoarthritis is inflammation of the joint, and this rotator cuff disorders are important. And the supraspinatus tendinitis is most common due to repeated actions. The supraspinatus tendon, it may get infected. It is referred to as supraspinatus tendinitis, and it further leads to inflammation of the bursa, which is just below the acromion, that is the subacromial bursitis. Okay, so in subacromial bursitis, two things are seen. One is painful arc syndrome, that means in this 60 to 90 degrees of abduction is affected. Okay, it is very painful when the patient tries to abduct the arm between 16 to 90 degrees. Okay, and Dauban sign is when in an adducted shoulder, when we press just below the acromion, there will be extreme pain in that region. But when the same point is pressed on abduction, pain disappears because the bursa slips under the acromion. Okay, subacromial bursa shifts below the acromion in an abducted shoulder. Okay, in an adducted shoulder, pain is there. In an abducted shoulder, pain disappears when a pressure is applied just below the acromion. That is referred to as Dauban sign. So we have briefly covered the shoulder joint in details. Let's move on to the next joint. Here we can say this is the elbow joint. So elbow joint is which type of joint? It is an example of a hinge variety of synovial joint. Okay. If you see elbow joint, it is actually formed by two joints. One is the joint between ulna and humerus, and another is the joint between radius and humerus. Okay. So this joint is a typical hinge joint between ulna and humerus. Okay, humero-ulnar joint. Humero-radial joint, it is structurally a ball and socket variety of synovial joint. Okay, ball component is formed by the capitulum and socket is formed by the depression, which is just above the head of the radius. But elbow joint overall is referred to as hinge joint because major component is formed by the ulna and the humerus. When more than two bones are taking part in the joint, that is referred to as a compound variety of synovial joint. You should know the differences between a compound joint and a complex joint. When more than two bones take part in the formation of the joint, that is a compound joint. And when there is an articular disc in between the joint cavity, that is referred to as a complex joint. Okay? Then articular surfaces. In the humerus, there is capitulum and trochlea. In the ulna, there is trochlear notch of the ulna and the head of the radius. Okay, these form the articular surfaces. Then ligaments of the shoulder joint. So since it is a synovial joint, there is a capsular ligament. Then on the medial aspect, there will be medial collateral ligament, also referred to as the ulnar collateral ligament. On the lateral aspect, there is radial collateral ligament, also referred to as the lateral collateral ligament. Okay. Let's study about various relations of the elbow joint. So in front of the elbow joint, there will be structures of the cubital fossa. So this, we can see the brachialis, which forms the floor of the cubital fossa. These are the contents of cubital fossa: median nerve, brachial artery, biceps tendon. Okay, all these structures form the anterior relations of the elbow joint. Then medial relations are formed by the flexor carpi ulnaris. Then there's a common flexor origin, which gives rise to the flexor muscles of the anterior compartment of the forearm and ulnar nerve. Okay. And lateral relations, there is extensor carpi radialis brevis, then common extensor origin. So these two structures form the lateral relations. In posterior relations, three structures are listed, that is the tendon of the triceps, anconeus, and small nerve to anconeus. Okay, so all these structures are forming the posterior relations of the elbow joint. So we have covered these four headings. Bursa around the elbow joint, there are three bursa which are listed. Just behind the olecranon process, there is subcutaneous olecranon bursa, and there is subtendinous olecranon bursa, and bicipito-radial bursa. Okay. Then blood supply of the elbow joint will be supplied by the anastomosis around the elbow joint. Okay, anastomosis is formed by the blood vessels, which are the brachial artery, the radial artery, and the ulnar artery. Okay, so these are the chief blood supply for the elbow joint. The nerve supply is by the major nerves of the upper limb. Okay, so which are the major nerves of the upper limb? The median nerve, ulnar nerve, radial nerve, as well as musculocutaneous nerve. Okay, all these nerves will supply the elbow joint. Movements of the elbow joint, since it is a typical hinge joint, only two movements are possible, that is flexion and extension. So flexion is brought about by which muscles? There is brachialis muscle, which is the chief flexor of the elbow joint, brachialis, as well as biceps brachii muscle. Okay, these two muscles cause flexion. Additionally, brachioradialis muscle can also cause flexion in semi-prone position. Okay, and extension is brought about by triceps brachii and anconeus. Anconeus is a weak extensor at the elbow joint. These are the various movements and muscles producing the movements. Let's cover the applied anatomy related to the elbow joint. So fluid may get collected in the elbow joint and it may push the joint capsule. And joint capsule is more pushed on the posterior aspect. Okay, in the posterior aspect, the joint capsule is little weak. So elbow effusion is more appreciated along the posterior aspect of the elbow. There may be dislocation of the elbow. Radius and ulna, it may displace from the joint line. And whenever there is dislocation, there is something called as three-point relation of the elbow, which is disturbed. Okay, so which are those 3 points? One is the olecranon process, then medial epicondyle and lateral epicondyle. Okay, usually they lie in one horizontal line, but when there is dislocation, this line will be disturbed. Okay, there is one more clinical condition called as the supracondylar fracture of the humerus. In that case, the 3-point relationship will be maintained. Okay, so this 3-point relationship is important to differentiate between elbow dislocation and supracondylar fracture of the humerus. And there is something called as nursemaid's elbow or pulled elbow. It usually occurs below 3 years of age. When we try to hold the babies with the forearm, so at times the radius, the head of the radius, it may get dislocated, or we can say subluxated from the capitulum. That is referred to as nursemaid's elbow or pulled elbow. Okay, and tennis elbow is inflammation of the lateral epicondyle. Lateral epicondylitis also, muscles which are attached along the lateral epicondyle, so these get inflamed in tennis elbow. Okay, so extensor or the extension of the forearm is affected in this condition. Then golfer's elbow is referred to as medial epicondylitis. Okay, when the medial epicondyle is inflamed, as well as when the muscles which are originating from the medial epicondyle, if they are inflamed, that is referred to as golfer's elbow. In this, there will be weakness in flexion of the forearm. Then student's elbow is the inflammation of the subcutaneous olecranon bursa. Okay, due to repeatedly keeping the elbow on the desk, at times that subcutaneous olecranon bursa that gets inflamed. Okay, so this is student's elbow. So the various applied anatomy with respect to the elbow joint. Let's cover the wrist joint now. So again, we'll be covering under the standard heading. So wrist joint is which type of joint? Is an example of a ellipsoid variety of synovial joint. Okay, one side is concave, other side is convex. Articulating surfaces is formed by the, on the proximal aspect there is the distal surface of the radius, and on the other side there is the proximal row of carpal bones. The capoid, lunate, as well as triquitral comes in extreme adduction. Okay, ulna doesn't take part in the formation of wrist joint. That is important. And wrist joint is also referred to as radiocarpal joint. Okay, so how ulna is separated from the wrist joint? Here we can see this structure. This is the articular disc which separates the ulna from the wrist joint. Then various ligaments of the wrist joint. Since it is a synovial joint, there will be capsular ligament. On the lateral aspect, there is radial collateral ligament. On the medial aspect, ulnar collateral ligament. Then on the anterior aspect, there is palmar radiocarpal ligament and palmar ulnocarpal ligament. Okay. And posteriorly, there is only ligament from radius to the carpal bone. So that will be referred to as dorsal radiocarpal ligament. So I'll repeat the ligaments again. One is the capsular ligament, then radial collateral ligament, ulnar collateral ligament, then palmar radiocarpal, palmar ulnocarpal, and on the dorsal aspect that is dorsal radiocarpal. Okay. Then relations at the wrist joint. For relations, we can imagine, so which all structures are in the front of the wrist joint? We can imagine the structures of the carpal tunnel. The flexor tendons, all flexor tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis, flexor digitorum profundus, median nerve, okay, they form the structures of the carpal tunnel. That will be on the anterior aspect, and posterior aspect there will be extensor tendons of the wrist and the digits. Okay, then laterally there is radial artery as well as the tendons of abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis, and medially there is a dorsal cutaneous branch of the ulnar nerve. Okay, so all these are the relations of the wrist joint. Then blood supply of wrist joint, it is by the palmar and the dorsal carpal arches. Okay, blood vessels which are surrounding it. Then nerve supply of the wrist joint. So there's a nerve on the anterior aspect of the wrist joint. There is anterior interosseous nerve, and nerve on the posterior aspect is posterior interosseous nerve. Okay, so these interosseous nerves supply the wrist joint. Movements are flexion, extension, adduction, abduction, and combination of these movements will be referred to as circumduction. Okay, so flexion is brought about by flexor carpi radialis, flexor carpi ulnaris, and palmaris longus. Extension brought about by extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi radialis brevis, and extensor carpi ulnaris. Then abduction will be brought about by flexor carpi radialis, extensor carpi radialis longus brevis, as well as there is abductor pollicis longus. And adduction is brought about by flexor carpi ulnaris and extensor carpi ulnaris. And this is the applied anatomy with respect to the wrist joint. Ganglion, it is a cystic swelling surrounding the tendons. Okay, a synovial sheath which surrounds the tendon that get inflamed and a swelling occurs, that is referred to as ganglion. Aspiration of the wrist joint is done whenever there is effusion in the wrist joint. And immobilization of the wrist means whenever the plaster cast has to be applied in this region, the position of the wrist should be 30 degrees dorsiflexion. Okay, it's referred to as the optimum position of the wrist joint. Okay, so this was about applied anatomy with respect to the wrist joint. Let's start with the first carpometacarpal joint. So it is which type of joint? It is an example of a saddle variety of synovial joint. Okay, saddle because concavo-convex articular surface. Articular surfaces, distal surface of the trapezium and proximal surface of the base of the first metacarpal. In ligaments, first ligament which we can remember is the capsular ligament, since it is a synovial joint. Then there is an anterior ligament, there is one posterior ligament, and there is one ligament on the lateral aspect, lateral ligament. So four ligaments are capsular ligament, anterior ligament, posterior ligament, and lateral ligament. In relations of first carpometacarpal joint, anteriorly there will be muscles of the ulnar eminence, posteriorly there will be extensors of the thumb. Okay, so extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis, those will be on the posterior aspect. Laterally there is abductor pollicis longus muscle, and medially there is first dorsal interossei muscle and radial artery. Okay, and blood supplies by the radial artery which is near to this joint. Nerve supplies by the median nerve which is close to this joint. In movements, multiple movements are possible: flexion, extension, adduction, abduction. There's an action which is called as position. Okay, and combination of all movements will be referred to as circumduction. Okay, movements in the plane of the palm is flexion and extension. Movements perpendicular to the plane of the palm is adduction and abduction. And when the thumb touches the other digit, that is referred to as opposition, and combination of all movements will be referred to as circumduction. Okay, and muscles producing these movements you can remember by the name. Flexion will be produced by flexor pollicis longus, flexor pollicis brevis. Extension will be produced by extensor pollicis longus brevis. Adduction by adductor pollicis. Then abduction by abductor pollicis longus and brevis. Opposition by opponent's pollicis. Okay, applied anatomy with respect to the first carpometacarpal joint. There is a clinical condition called as De Quervain's tenosynovitis. It is inflammation of the tendons of abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. Okay, and ape thumb deformity in which the thumb lies close to the palm. It is due to the injury of the median nerve. Okay, so in carpal tunnel syndrome, or if there is injury of median nerve higher up, will lead to ape thumb deformity. And Bennett's fracture, it is fracture of the base of the first metacarpal bone. okay, so that will affect the first upper metacarpal joint. Okay, so this was all the major joints of the upper limb. So which other joints are left? One is the acromioclavicular joint, the lateral end of the clavicle. It articulates with the acromion process of the scapula. It is a plain variety of synovial joint. Sternoclavicular joint on the medial aspect, the medial end of the clavicle, it articulates with the sternum, that is sternoclavicular joint. It is a sidal variety of synovial joint. Okay, and both these joints are complex type because there is articular disc which intervenes between the joint cavity. Okay, then radio ulnar joints, superior radio ulnar joint and inferior radio ulnar joint, these are pivot variety of synovial joint. And middle radio ulnar joint is a syndesmosis. Okay, it's an example of a fibrous joint. These are the joints in the hand. First carpometacarpal we have studied, that was a sidal variety of synovial joint. Remaining are plain variety of synovial joint. Okay, intercarpal joints are also plain variety of synovial joint. Intermetacarpal joints are also plain variety. And metacarpophalangeal joint, this is a ellipsoid variety of synovial joint. And interphalangeal joint, it is a hinge variety of synovial joint. Let's summarize what we have covered in this particular session. So in this summary, I've just listed down the various types of the joint which are present in upper limb. Shoulder joint is ball and socket, and elbow joint is a hinge joint, wrist is an ellipsoid joint, first carpometacarpal, sidal variety of synovial joint, acromioclavicular and sternoclavicular, plane and saddle. Superior inferior radio ulnar is a pivot variety of synovial joint. Middle radio ulnar joint is a syndesmosis. Okay, so if you see the joints, only one joint is fibrous, that is the middle radio ulnar joint. Rest all joints are synovial joint. Okay, so this also we have covered. Maximum joints in the hand are plane synovial joints. Metacarpophalangeal joint is ellipsoid and interphalangeal joint is a hinge joint. Okay, so we have covered all the joints of the upper limb. So if you all want PDF handout, you can you all can request at this WhatsApp number, and please do watch other videos of this YouTube channel. Okay, thank you.